Hello and welcome to the Ladies' Room. Today it is my extreme great pleasure to have with me my friend Jonathan Glynn, who we just discovered we know each other for 23 years, the good old days. But anyway, Jonathan is the founder of Wings Over Haiti, which started its first school in Quatre-Bouquet right after the earthquake 9 years ago, 0.7 on the Richter scale, and it destroyed Haiti. And that school, he planted a seed, and it's growing like a just, it's amazing. You're quite a humanitarian. So now you are starting your second school in Ranquette.
Yeah.
You say either, I say neither. we have a little film of what's going on there. So we'd love to show you the film, and then we will talk about it on the other side, as they say. Okay.
I'm Jonathan Glynn, the Sag Harbor pilot that flew to Haiti after the earthquake and founded Wings Over Haiti.
We are holding our third annual benefit on Saturday, June 22nd from 5:30 to 8:30 p.m. at East Hampton Airport.
Magali Theodore approached me and told me that she had a school in Ranquette and designated the 7 acres that we'll be using for the sole purposes of education for the community.
The first four classrooms are built. We'll go from 40 students the first year and double it the second year.
This event is going to bring us to the finish line of the infrastructure on the buildings.
We'll be able to pay administrators and teachers and get some employment in the village.
The idea would be to get the solar panels on, get the pumps in, and start to bring water there so they can have their first taste of plumbing.
This is our third annual Hampton's Artists for Haiti event. There are probably 50 paintings and photographs. It's a chance for artists to show and for people to buy art. It's just that we're doing it in a hangar.
It's going to give the parents hope. It's going to give the kids a future. It's going to give the community a focus.
Wings of Haiti really want to give them an opportunity to be a children, to be a big kid again.
If you start a school and the children are happy and they love to learn, the children go home and try to teach their parents. It's an energy that changes the whole nature of what is initially a very desperate situation, the one that offers hope.
These children are going to have the possibility to become the next best person that they want to become.
When you see these kids flower from nothing, they love being in school. They don't like to leave the schools. Our first school is like a Garden of Eden in probably one of the worst places in our hemisphere.
I really have to hand it to Jonathan. Going into a post-apocalyptic Haiti and starting a school within months, I mean, that's pretty incredible. There was a real ripple effect to what he's done.
To have an art show and a benefit, both, and to have Jonathan be one of the artists in the benefit, it's the highlight of the year.
We're not changing Haiti. We're changing children's lives that have nothing. Like, worse than you could ever even imagine.
Building a school and providing education for children who have nothing. I don't think there's anything more satisfying.
So the bottom line is, you should join us on June 22nd for our third annual Hampton Artists for Haiti Gala. We have lots in store, and basically your dollars are going to be going towards the operational expenses of our second school. I look forward to seeing you at the event, and I know you're going to have a great time.
Go to wingsoverhaiti.net for tax-deductible tickets. That's wingsoverhaiti.net. See you there.
So that was amazing. So that first school is like blossoming like crazy. And they had trumpets, so where did they get all, do they have a lot of musical instruments?
Or? Well, now they do. I mean, the first school, you know, we bought that land and there was nothing on it. So it's a real sense of pride and accomplishment to see how far those kids have come now.
Yeah.
Like with grants, we started, get some fresh water.
You sunk a well, right?
Sunk a
it's
well.
The first time they ever. Yeah. So do they all come and get water from that well, or?
Well, they do. The community uses it too. It's filtrated water. And then over the, since it's been 9 years now, they keep getting grants. And
you add a grade every year.
A grade every year. That's
so
right.
So seventh grade up to seventh grade now. Started with nursery school.
Yeah. And it's 3 acres of land. They have community gardens, basketball courts, a community center, musical instruments, bicycles. I mean, the kids just don't want to leave the enclave.
But you see how beautiful the school is, and then, like, right next door are the shacks.
Well, at night so they go home and they sleep on dirt floors or five or six and more to a bed.
Cots, nine in a room.
And tin roofs. And
if you could call it a room.
No electricity. I mean, this is one of the poorest regions in our hemisphere.
The world.
And in the world, really.
In the world. Yeah. I was reading in Judy DeMillo's a wonderful article in the East Hampton Star that the United States government doesn't even give any aid to Haiti. They give aid to, like, Egypt and Israel. And I wrote down.
It's true.
Yeah, crazy places. Iraq, Afghanistan. Egypt, Jordan, Israel, they're all rich countries, but they don't give the aid to the poor.
Well, there's no advantage in any way. If anything, they want to keep, I mean, I
there's
don't know,
no trade, there's
they're
no
not really interested
political
in helping
clout,
them
that's what they're after.
Yeah,
but
it's geopolitical. I don't think people are that interested in Haiti. There's not much harm it can do to the U.S., but it's also really no benefit either. So what you have is a lot of impoverished kids there, in a very dicey situation. And to me, it's not really about Haiti. To me, that it's within a few hours of here, you have kids starving to
starving.
Death. I mean, you see that all around the world, but it's accessible for Wings Over Haiti and the team to make a difference. And it doesn't cost a lot to make a big difference in their lives. You could see from that video that the kids, they start out, they're just sad, pathetic, they don't eat, they're, and then within a very short period of time with medical attention and food and education, they just, I mean, they're so happy. I mean, even if the kids here could be as happy as they are to learn, they never want to leave the school. And we're hoping that, well, we can see, we know that it's made a big difference in their lives and the communities already, but we're also hoping that it'll make a difference for their country and that they will give back. And over time, and hopefully in my life, I'll be able to see that some of our kids will make a big difference. Mm-hmm. So
Rankit now, they had a school.
Rankit had a school for 400 kids. And we plan on resuscitating that after the earthquake. And for a number of reasons, it fell apart. And so there's no education in that region. It's in the mountains. It's even hard for us to get there now. So we're building accommodations, and we just finished our first school there, which will accommodate 80 students towards the 400.
Uh-huh.
And
is
we're
that
hoping to
open, or it's going to open in?
Well, it's not open yet, but we're hoping to open this September.
Uh-huh.
And that's why we're having a fundraiser.
Right.
And we're going to get there, but we still need about $70,000.
Yeah.
And we're going to work hard to try to generate
interest. And the $70,000 will do the whole school for the 400?
Well, no, it'll do the school for 40 to 80 kids, but it will also, it'll jumpstart the infrastructure, which means it will get water filtration to we'll get a kitchen going so we can feed.
Do you have to sink a well there, or do they have a well?
They have a well, but we really need to test it and get it back functioning and then filter the water. And then we need to interview teachers and then select our original students. And it starts slowly, but it builds quickly.
Yeah.
We just want to make sure our infrastructure is sound and that the teachers, we have very trustworthy and excellent administrators. And so we like to start small, and then as with our first school, we'll increase a grade each year. It's advantageous to us to start with a preschool, get the kids and the family used to coming to a school. I mean, they have never seen a book, these kids. They had never had a routine where they're going to show up for school. Right. So it all works sort of organically. And as you can see from the first school, I mean, it's just thriving and, you know, and it's just very energetic. But you have to start slow, and then we'll make it happen again, and eventually in the near future, hopefully, have 400 kids.
Right. So I saw Al Tufts is down there, and so do the local families, the fathers and the sons that are older, do they get involved in the construction? Are they all excited about getting the school done?
Well, it's interesting. We're sort of like dropped into the middle of nowhere. So even though Magali Theodore, our Haitian partner who grew up there and whose father started that first school, knows people and it's a communicator for us, I mean, we still have to build bonds and trust. Yeah. And it's a process.
Yeah.
And the community will be involved. But right now we're sort of like, they need to trust us. Now what they've seen is that we've been coming back for 3 years now, and now there's a really good, strong, earthquake-resistant building with four classrooms for 20 kids each that's up and ready to roll. So they can see that we're not kidding around. And then I think that you build trust in the community, then they help you. Right now, we've had outside people and contractors come in and get the building up. Yeah. But what we'll need their help for is food and food production, and basically
but
to help volunteer.
Community, yeah, so it's a farming community, so it's ahead of the game from Quatre Bouquets.
Yeah, and we're going to take advantage of that and also help them get a greater crop and show that we're as interested in them as their kids. Uh-huh. And then it all works together. It's a slow process, but it's kind of exciting.
What lessons did you learn from Quatre Bouquets that you can apply to Rankit?
Well, that's interesting. I mean, what we learned from making a lot of mistakes in the beginning of our first, is that, first of all, we had one of our children die from malnutrition, even though we had Haitian teachers, because he was bringing home the food that we gave him to feed his parents.
Oh, my God.
And we didn't know about that. So then immediately we stopped everything and we said, all right, these kids have to be fed twice a day, get medical attention, because you can't have a school if kids aren't healthy. So we learned that we have to feed them. Initially, and then actually
were
not initially,
were you giving them one meal a day initially?
Initially it was one meal, and now it's two, and that's pretty part of that game plan. We learned that we have to get the community involved and to do the best we can and inform them what's going on. I guess we learned a lot of things, you know, I mean, I can just go through it, but our goal is to make the school self-sustaining. Right. So we really have to keep in touch with administrators that are committed to being there and families that are committed to the school.
Is Magali's family still there, the Theodores? Do they still live there?
No, I don't think
They're all in New York now?
She has property there and people know her there.
And her dad donated the 7 acres to the school?
Yes. Her father died, but it became into a trust, and then the trust is now given to Wings Over Haiti as long as we have a school there.
Right.
And so that's a big, giant step.
It's huge.
It took us 2 years in the first school just to get land there. And then we realized, that was one of the other things, that there's a certain formula. You have to have a Haitian partner, and you need to buy the land. You need to protect it because you need to control it. You know, once you have these things lined up, you can really do well, and it's.
So when you say you need to protect it, do you have to have guards at night around the school?
Well, not only do we have guards, but we have cement walls around the property.
Have what? Walls?
Cement walls.
Cement walls.
Yeah.
Cement walls. Put glass on top of the walls or anything like that? In Bali, you think Bali's like this paradise. my Dutch friend had a house there, and he said the crime is so horrible. You have to have walls around your property with glass on the top to protect yourself. It's so sad.
Well, when you're in a nation that's as poor as Haiti,
you
almost
hungry.
Can understand that if there's something out there within their grasp, they're going to take it.
So you have kitchens at the schools?
With kitchens, and then we also have ways to from manure to be able to fuel in order to cook the food. It's a very
manure
self-sustaining environment. Yeah.
Interesting. I know they do that in Africa.
There's endless things that you can do to keep it so it doesn't cost that much to keep the program running. Mm-hmm.
So there's a river on your property, right? Is it a big river, a little river?
Well, we just got a text this morning, from Magalie with a photograph from yesterday, that because it's the rainy season, we have a river that runs through our property, and we hope to have cisterns underneath the building so that we can hold on to this water throughout the more difficult drought times. Sometimes it's a trickle of water, but it is a stream. Right now it's flowing. So we're lucky also to have a source of water. These are wonderful things that give us a giant step for the second school.
Yeah, there's a lot of rivers in Haiti. Do you know about Sans Souci? It's up in the north. They, I guess Jean Christophe, the one that got all the Haitians together to declare independence, they built all these cisterns and a whole tiered, it's huge. It's like, I guess they learned from the Europeans what the Romans did to collect water. And it's in ruins now, but it's quite amazing. And it's up on the way to the citadel because he...
Well, Haiti has a rich culture. Yeah. They're very distinctive. You can hear it in their music, see it in their art. I mean, it's a wonderful culture, and yet it's extremely poor. So it's unique. They're strong-willed people, and it's fascinating to be able to work down there.
Yeah. Is the river fairly clean, or
we need to test the water more.
They're upstream, throw the garbage in the river.
We need to test the water.
Yeah,
we haven't gotten that far yet.
So, Ranquit is just 10 miles from Port-au-Prince, correct?
No.
Farther?
Coati Bouquet, where the first school is 10 miles from Port-au-Prince.
Okay.
And Ranquit is about 6 hours from Port-au-Prince in the mountains.
Oh.
I mean, it's in a very desolate area where there's just tons of kids that have nothing and no education.
Interesting.
No opportunities.
So it's higher up, so
yeah.
It's cooler temperature?
Cooler temperature, a little safer. It's agriculturally based, so we should be able to have sustainable food source. But it is remote, and during the rainy season, the roads are wiped out. There's a lot of extra challenges for us now, but it's also safer and not quite as desperate as the first school we did in the environment.
And there's a pastor that lives sort of near there, or he's...
Yeah, Pastor Caleb. He's about 30 miles away in Pinon, and he has a school for 1,000 kids. So he's a really good mentor for us to be
great.
Able to get resources and to maybe to have curriculum developments, things like that.
Is he the pastor that was in Southampton that used to collect money for kids?
No, it's
different. It's a different one.
He's down there permanently, and he's a friend of Magley's in Pinon, which is. It's considerable distance, but he has a lot of experience.
Well, how long has his school been going?
Oh, for many years. Uh-huh. Most of his life. He's built up an incredible school, 1,000 kids, as I said. So we're lucky to have him as a resource, and he supports what we do because it's too far away from what he's doing. But he recognizes that there's a real need. There's an endless need in Haiti.
Yeah, endless.
I mean, one of the things that I'm looking forward to in Ranquit this time, once we get it up and running, is to work with the community and also kind of look into sort of a Planned Parenthood situation there.
Oh, interesting.
So, so it's just because the problem is so deep, you can have an endless amount of schools, but they're human beings that are in desperate situations. So
when you see
family planning, it's not the worst thing. I mean, it might cause a little bit resistance, but now after doing this for 9 years, I realize it has to be an integral part of the education.
Yeah,
I think.
Yeah, a whole picture for the community. When you see the smiling faces of those children in their uniforms, and they look so healthy and happy, and blows my mind that they have a lot of music. Because
if it wasn't for these kids, I wouldn't be doing it. I mean, really, the hardest part is to not be around the kids while you're preparing to get a school started. Once the kids start coming, you go, oh, that's why I'm doing this. Because they're so incredible when they're
Did you
happy.
Build a basketball court or a little soccer field or anything to keep them busy while you're getting the school going? I mean, do they have any
Well, I mean, the basketball court... is like secondary to education, but
no,
in the
know,
first go we have
until,
basketball courts, soccer field. We do have a lot of land in this Rankine, so
yeah.
I think we could get, we have already soccer balls donated, and we'll probably be getting recreation into, and that's a good, you know, good idea, and also you have to keep them entertained while you're working,
right.
Getting the kinks out of
right.
The situation. So, yeah, we're going to have a, soccer will be a big part of this second school.
Yeah, and it keeps them healthy and active.
Yeah. And they, you know, they haven't seen a ball, just like they've never seen a book. Like what they're doing there is just so pathetic. So that's going to change quickly, starting in September. Although I do want to encourage viewers that if they are up for it, we need another $70,000 to get this up and running.
And even if they don't live near here, if they're watching this online, because this streams online, so anyone can watch it on their computer. On LTV EastHampton.org, and so they get on videos on demand, and they put the ladies' room in the search bar, and then all the shows come up, and your show will
great.
Be the newest.
And they can
one,
also go to WingsOverHaiti.net.
Oh, the new website is great.
Yeah.
WingsOverHaiti.net.
And it's a very easy to access website.
Yeah.
A lot of information. And they can make a donation, right, from WingsOverHaiti.net.
And any little bit helps, like, what, $10 feeds
$10
a kid for a month?
Well, yeah, I mean, it's $1.50 a day for two meals and an education.
Yeah.
And that includes everything. I mean, it's fantastic.
Really, and 100% of the money goes
100%
to the school.
100% goes to the school. There's no salaries, very little administration costs, you know, aside from an accountant and things like that. But everybody's volunteer, and it's a wonderful team of people. So if they go to the website, I mean, people will see a lot more, too.
The event's going to be amazing because it's at East Hampton Airport. You're going to have the planes outside so kids can, like, get in the planes and see what
it'll
like
be a lot
to
of fun.
Be
this
a
is
pilot.
Coming this weekend.
This weekend, Saturday. Yeah.
And I'm appreciative of you and LTV for putting us on. So we can let the local community
LTV is a wonderful
encourage them
thing.
To come.
We love our LTV. Yeah, the benefit's going to be great. We're having a tent, a band first, and then the DJ.
Well, no, it's going to be a DJ
just
tent.
The DJ.
Great food, raffle prizes, and then
and
it's
you're
Hampton artists
for a trip to Haiti.
And that too, yeah.
Yeah, they're auctioning a trip to Haiti and for the grand opening of the school.
Yeah.
That'll be really interesting.
Nice. And then, of course, there's over 50 local artists that are going to be, are generously donated work towards our cause. And so there'll be a lot of interesting people there and great art, great food. And it's at a crazy location, and it's three private hangars. And the airport's been very accommodating because they believe in what we're doing. And I'm really looking forward to it.
It's going to be a fun evening.
There'll be some dancing and this and that.
Dancing, yeah. So the last 2 years it was at Watermill Center, and boy, at 8:30 they were flickering the lights and wanting us out of there. But now we're going to be at the airport.
Yeah, the airport has been very generous.
Yeah.
It allows us to have more people and actually to not be stressed out that we have to leave at an exact time and that sort of thing.
Get everything cleaned up by 8:45, and they're pushing us out the door. But so it's going to be a wonderful evening, and the ticket sales are doing well.
Oh, we're doing really well.
And you just have to get on WingsOverHaiti.net and click on
Correct.
Buy tickets.
Perfect.
You got them.
Thank you again for doing this for us and all that you do, Judy.
Anything to help, really. It's just such a wonderful cause, and really everyone feels the same way, that it's just, you're such a humanitarian and everyone involved. It's so important because...
Well, I'm really lucky because I get to work with great people, and it's like these are my good friends, and it sort of all works together. It turned out so great, you know.
And it's amazing that you can buck the Haitian government because it's so corrupt.
Well, you know, they don't have a lot of schools. They don't support schools. So as long as we're not interfering, they don't interfere with us. They give us accreditation. And so far, so good. I mean, I have friends that are in the government. As long as they leave us alone, we're doing well.
Yeah.
I mean, we can change and affect the lives of a lot of human beings?
I was just curious to know if you knew anything of the inside story of what happened to the money from the Clinton Foundation. Because I know the money went there.
I have no inside information, but I go down there a lot. And when I hear about how they spent the money, something
they
has to do with hotel
money.
Management or starting a hotel.
Crazy stuff.
He wrote me a letter and congratulated for what we did, what we've been doing. And so then I wrote him a letter back. I said, well, why don't you support what we're doing? And then I never got a letter back. I think we need to pursue that a little further.
Yeah,
I
mean, pursue it, because yeah. the money did go there.
Yeah,
the money did go there.
There was a lot earmarked for it, and I'm hoping that they end up spending it towards where the money was earmarked.
Yeah,
well. As you mentioned before, there's not a lot of available monies for what we're doing.
No. So $70,000, and it's going to build a school for 400 children who you can see are just thriving and loving it and learning music, and they will grow up to become teachers.
Yeah.
And it goes on and on and on, and it will grow and grow.
Just beautiful kids. In our first school, they're speaking two or three languages now. They're doing great on standardized tests. There's no reason why they can't go to college. And if you saw where they're coming from, you just wouldn't believe it.
Yeah. Well, we did get a little snippet of where they're coming from. Yeah. Well, it's a joy to have you. I'm going to be selling raffle tickets. So bring $20 to buy 12 raffle tickets. It's a lot of good prizes. And it's going to be a great evening. June 22nd, 5:30 at the East Hampton Airport. We hope to see you. Thank you for coming, Jonathan. I always enjoy seeing you.
Thanks for having me, Judy.
And thank you for joining us. And remember, ladies, give yourself, and men, give yourself lots of room. Room for love. First of all, love. You're spreading love in Haiti. Room for fun, room to grow, and room to glow. Put on your best duds and come dance with us Saturday night.
Excellent.
Okay.
Okay. Cheers.
Cheers. Breathe in. Breathe in. Take. Oh, good and stop. Couldn't stop, no, couldn't stop.